religion. But there is no real visible evidence that they have good religion. See, this hymn comes out of the pains and problems, the sufferings and struggles, the opposition and oppression of the black religious experience. Religion, yes, but good religion, no. Let me say it again, let me say it. Religion, yes, but good religion, no. You see, many have a religion that reaches upward, a religion that points heavenward. There's a vertical relationship that runs north and south. It's a religion running north and south, but it's not good religion. What our ancestors in the Christian religion were saying is that good religion reaches upward and outward. Good religion is heavenward and earthbound. Good religion runs north and south and east and west. Good religion is vertical and horizontal. So some have religion, but they don't have good religion. You cannot represent Christ with the vertical bar that only reaches up to Him. The religion of Jesus Christ has also a horizontal bar that also reaches out to others. Jesus was not only hung high, He was stretched wide. He was stretched wide. He died on the cross. Good religion is a religion of the cross. Dr. C.J.W. Clark, late Dr. C.J.W. Clark of Dallas, Texas, would often say, some of us are so heavenly minded that we are no earthly good. The cross, the pathway to power, authority, and victory. The cross where the character of God is revealed. The cross, God's love for lost sinners and God's perfect justice meet at the cross. The destiny of Jesus to fulfill the mission assigned by God led Him to the cross. Much is preached, much is taught, much is said about the cross and how the life of Jesus ended on planet level. But today I want to say something about the beginning of the ministry of Jesus. According to Luke's gospel, Jesus had just been tempted in the wilderness, and after three temptations, Jesus knocked Satan out in the third round.
My God.
And immediately, He went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day. In other words, after knocking Satan out, He went to church on the Lord's day. And He opened the book, God's inspired holy word, and turned to Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Watch this, because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recover the sight of the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. Look, if you will, the categories of the ministry of Jesus. Are you praying now? Look at the categories of the ministry of Jesus. We know that He had a relationship with His Father, but look at His category. Look at those to whom Jesus was anointed to minister. The poor, the brokenhearted, captives, the blind, the bruised, the poor, the prisoners, the blind, the oppressed. And His assignment was to proclaim good news, free those imprisoned by their past and their culture, give sight to those who are blind to opportunities and potential, and liberate those who are oppressed. That is what Jesus was anointed to do. My beloved of the Lord, in Isaiah's day, God anointed the church to do so. In the ministry of Jesus, God anointed the church to do so. And likewise, in our day, God has anointed the church to proclaim good news, free the imprisoned, open the eyes of the The assignment of Jesus is the assignment of the church. Because whatever Jesus did, the church is to do. Whatever Jesus was about, the church is to be about. During Black History Month, I believe the Lord would have us to remind us that the black church was compelled into existence to counter the claims of a Christian religion where a person could worship God, the Father of all mankind, on a Sunday, and then on Monday return to the fields as a slave and an inferior people. The spirit of the black slave had him to know that there was something wrong with a vertical upward reach on Sunday and no outward reach toward justice and fairness to others on Monday. I'm talking about the black slave. How could a human being be saved in Christ vertically and then shackled and bound by dehumanizing him? Are y'all praying right now? And a derogatory institution of slavery on Monday. Listen, though unlearned and many illiterate, there was something within them that made them know this was wrong. The Creator God of the heavens, whose love flows freely to all mankind, could not uphold and honor a system that denies human dignity and pride. The God of mercy had already shown himself to be a liberator of people when he told Moses to go and tell the Pharaoh of Egypt to let my people go. It was the unwavering faith of our ancestors in chattel slavery that gave birth to the invisible virtues of the black church. It was the black church that gave black folk hope during slavery, segregation, the Jim Crow era. The black church. The black, let me say it again. The black church. Let me say it again. The black church gave us hope. The black church kept the flames of freedom burning in the hearts of our people. During the civil rights movement of the 50s and the 60s, it was again the black church that took the initiative and led the charge against an unjust, racist, segregating society. Were it not for the black pastor standing at the black pulpit in the black church, the civil rights movement would never gain the momentum in championing the cause of justice and fairness and opportunity for all. It was the black church. And it bothers me when I hear folks say that the black church is irrelevant. We've got to know something about history. Persons who criticize and ridicule and demean the black church are ignorant and uninformed about its noble history. For black folk had any kind of formal organization to protest the evils of slavery, it was the black church that kept hope alive. Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois stated that the only social institution among the Negroes which started in the African forest and survived slavery was the church. God forbid if I'm in error. But the Spirit of the Living and the Living Lord speaks to me. And I pray that I'm hearing the Spirit of the Living Lord clearly. Because it's bringing to my understanding that the black church is losing its horizontal reach to others in this modern church era. It doesn't matter anymore to us. We want what we want on a Sunday morning, and so churches are becoming worship stations.
Come on, Pastor.
And the only concern is that vertical reach. God forbid me if I'm wrong. Because what I'm noticing is, Brother Joseph James, there is a new kind of enslavement which is debilitating, demoralizing, dangerous, damaging, and destructive. Economic empowerment in the black community is in serious question. Shortly after slaves were emancipated in 1863, they came together, pooled their financial resources, and they worked together collectively to build schools and colleges for the education of the free slaves. During segregation in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, black folk came together, pooled their financial resources, and worked together to own movie theaters. How many movie theaters do we own in South Carolina now? Restaurants, motels, dry cleaners, service stations, grocery stores, pharmacies, and other businesses. There was a collective entrepreneur spirit that provided job opportunities and employment for people. We own our businesses, our own businesses. They knew our unlearned, no college degree grandparents and great grandparents. They knew that if you don't own anything, you don't have anything. Now, I need you to help me because I'm struggling as we go forward with this economic empowerment initiative. Help me to understand, how is it that some 50 and 60 years later, we have less ownership of businesses collected by other people than we did then? How is it that other ethnic groups can move right into our neighborhoods, right into our communities, and within a few years start their own businesses, and we've been living all our lives? I submit to you that the hour is now that we as a people reclaim the power of collective strength that characterized our predecessors who pioneered the way for the comforts and conveniences we enjoy today. And I want to pause back here and ask you all to give God a hand clap of praise for those people who pioneered the way and made it possible for us to go to the school that we attend, have the jobs we have, live in the place of the day. We need to praise God for the blood, sweat, and tears.
Continue increasing debt
and spending everything that comes to us. We spend too much and save too little. Now let me make this point clear. The best way to make this point clear is for you to count in dollars and cents the monetary value of what you are wearing right now. How much did your suit cost? Let me break it down. How much did that dress cost that you got on there? How much did the suit cost? How much did the tie cost? How much did the tie cost? How much did the shirt cost? How much did the shoes cost? Because guess what? Most of us have more money on our backs than we have in the bank.
My sincere prayer is that we will rethink our position on economic empowerment.
Hosea 4:6 says, watch this, my people are destroyed because of a lack of knowledge. And so though you may have some problems with this word today, this word is providing knowledge to you. But the text doesn't just stop there, because it goes on to say, some are destroyed because they reject knowledge. It's one thing to be uninformed, but another thing to be informed and still continue the ways that are defeated. If we are always in debt, if you are afraid to open bills and are running from creditors, if you're one of the persons who tell your children when a telephone call comes on, tell them I'm not. If you charge cards are always stretched to the limit and you're always robbing Peter to pay Paul, it won't be because of a lack of knowledge. It will be because you have rejected knowledge. I spoke briefly with Dr. Nathan on yesterday evening, and he did not know that, but he gave me the transitional statement for the sermon today, because he said to me, he said, this present administration, with President Donald Trump, is a wake-up call. Trying to do hard here. vendors. We give so much to others, and they're not giving enough back to us. Remember, I am because we are. We must deliver a good product with excellent service. It's a wake-up call to deliver a good product with excellent service. Now, come on, let's be honest. One of the reasons we don't use black businesses is because you can't always depend on black businesses. We do messed up work and don't be responsible for it. We want not to. Yeah, I messed up. Here's your return. I'm giving you the money back. We take the money and go hide, and you can't find us. We're unprofessional and often irresponsible. We say we're going to be at your home at 9 a.m., but then don't get there at 12 noon, and then leave for lunch at 1 p.m.
Trust and envy for control purposes. He understood.
understood that distrust is stronger than trust, and envy is stronger than admiration or respect. So he said, do this. He told him, pit the dark skin black folk against the light skin black folk. Make the light skin black folk think that they're better than the dark skin black folk. So that deacon evangelist dude back there coming on right now. The old male versus the young male. Those with kinky hair versus straight hair. Those in the big house against those in the fields. Make sure blacks distrust blacks, but trust, depend on, love, and respect the slave owner, the white man. Make them think that white ice is colder than black ice. Well, it's now 2017. Yeah. Is that, does anybody hear what I'm saying here? That was like 1712 when you told him to do this now. It is now 2017 since he gave that speech. The question is, did it work? Reverend Joseph said, is it working? In great degree, it looks like in some instances, it's still working. We hate on each other too much. We can't celebrate other folks' successes like God would have us to celebrate other folks' successes. Sometimes we try to bring others down who are doing well. We don't want to see someone with anything we don't have. And I'm willing to work hard enough to get it for ourselves.
Have you got the religion? Have you got the religion in the balcony? I didn't hear from the balcony at all. Have you got the religion in the balcony? What about on the pie? Have you got the religion? Thank you all so much. God bless you. God bless you. On Wednesday, I'm scheduled to lecture to the 52 Baptist churches of the Gethsemane Congress Association. The greatest thing in Baptist Church is 7 o'clock. And the Lord gave me that for you. I said, Lord, I will share that with all the churches. So I'm going to share it with all the churches. And Wednesday, 7 o'clock, the greatest thing in Baptist Church.